This video is brought to you by AKSIAS.
Right. So now, which topic? Since there is no unanimity, we'll start with this Pakistan business. Is it okay? As you know, Pakistan is a relatively young country. For about 5,000 years, it was a part of India. Pakistan has no history of its own, or Bangladesh also. They were all part of India. It's only from 1947 that there is a separate country called Pakistan, and the eastern part of that Pakistan, it became Bangladesh in 1971. So, let us find out what is this Pakistan business. Pakistan was created by IUML, Indian Union Muslim League. The first demand for a separate country for Muslims came from the Bengali Muslims, not the Punjabi Muslims. The Bengali Muslims wanted a separate country for Muslims. And therefore, there was a demand. That demand got a lot of strength when an English-speaking lawyer, a Shia by name Muhammad Ali Jinnah, whose wife was a Parsi lady and he was a drinking Muslim, under pure Islam, sharab peena shirk, it's forbidden. But this fellow drank every day. He did not have even a sherwani. He always wore those European clothes, coats. And he practiced for a long time in London. But suddenly he said, I want a separate country for Muslims. Muslims and Indians cannot live. So the British liked that idea of partitioning. They already partitioned a country called Ireland in 1923. Ireland, for about 300 years, like India, was a colony. If you, I forgot to tell you, whenever you attend my class, you must bring atlas. This, any kind of atlas, it doesn't matter. Now, if you have an atlas, open it. If you don't have, smartphones. Okay, so now you find out where is this Britain, B-R-I-T-A-I-N. Okay, are all of you able to see a map of Britain, a big map of Britain? Not a small map, big map. Ah, good, very good. She has got excellent map, because that also has Ireland, that also has Scotland. So anyway, so if all of you are ready, I'll start explaining the relationship between the creation of Pakistan and partition of Ireland. Pakistan was created in 1947. Ireland was partitioned in 1923. So that is a model that they adopted. Okay. Now look at me. Don't look at the map. There are two islands. One is a big island called Britain. The other is another island, Dvipam, I-S-L-A-N-D, called Ireland, I-R-E-L-A-N-D. They are adjacent to each other. Britain consists of three countries. The northernmost country is called Scotland, which was independent till about 14th or even 15th century. It had its own king. Ultimately, it became one with England in 1605, after the death of Elizabeth, 1603 or 1605, I'm not very sure. Elizabeth, Queen Elizabeth I, never got married, so she never had children. And when she died, a distant relative of theirs is King James VI of Scotland. So he was invited. You please come and become the King of England also. Between Scotland and England, England was a bigger country. So he came to England and never went back to Scotland. So his name in Scotland is King James VI. But in England, he is King James I. So, under him, they had two different countries with one king, common king. Do you understand now? Even today, Scotland is a different country. It has its own parliament, it has its own laws. But Scotland, England, Wales and Northern Ireland put together is the United Kingdom. That's a different matter. Queen is one. Now we go back to the medieval times. Even before Scotland became a part of, a common king, Scotland and England, the England king conquered Wales, W-A-L-E-S. It will be there. It has a land border with England, Wales. Since then, Wales, though they speak a different language, it is a part of United Kingdom. Sometime in the 14th century itself, some of the powerful people from England, they went especially to the northern part of Ireland, a neighboring island, by ship and occupied some land and converted that Ireland, entire Ireland, into a colony, C-O-L-O-N-Y, the way they converted India into a colony. But there was an Irish freedom movement towards the end of 19th century, exactly like India, Balagangadhar Tilak and others, later on Mahatma Gandhi. So there also they had an Irish freedom movement. And eventually they gave independence to Ireland in 1923. But before giving independence, they said there is a large population of Protestants in the northern part of Ireland. The southern part and main Ireland has Roman Catholics. So, they divided Ireland into two countries, Northern Ireland and Irish Republic in 1923. Irish Republic even today is a member of the European Union. It is a Catholic country and it is as prosperous as any other European country. Northern Ireland, which has majority Protestants, but a substantial minority of Roman Catholics, it is a part of United Kingdom. So United Kingdom has four countries. What are the four? And Northern Ireland. All four have a common head. The head of the state is Queen Elizabeth II. Okay. But they have their own parliaments. Wales does not have its own parliament. Scotland has its own parliament. That was repeated in 1947 in India. Because people like Jinnah said, we want a separate country for Muslims. And therefore, they engaged a lawyer who never visited India. He is a man practicing law in London, Cyril Radcliffe, R-A-D-C-L-I-F-F-E. He was brought to India and told not to meet anybody. He was kept in a guest house and given some maps and said, you decide which should be, which villages, which states, which area should be part of Pakistan. And whatever is not part of Pakistan is India. So he took a big thick pencil and drew one like this and one like that. The western part is West Pakistan. The eastern part, which is almost the existing state of East Bengal, with some minor adjustments. That was declared to be East Pakistan. Both is one country with two official languages, Urdu and Bengali. Their original Pakistani currency had the letters written in both Urdu as well as Bengali. Unfortunately, the domination of the Punjabi Pakistan was so much that ultimately Bangladeshis didn't want to be part of Pakistan. They broke away in 1971 during the war between India and Pakistan. So that became an independent country. Now they have overtaken even India in Human Development Index. Are you aware that Bangladesh is more advanced than India is? And of course, India and Bangladesh both are more advanced than Pakistan. Pakistan is one of the most primitive countries. So the creation of Pakistan was based on religion. And for this purpose, the British Parliament passed an act. The name of the act is Indian Independence Act. Under the Indian Independence Act, the British left. When they left, they gave independence only to that portion which was directly ruled by them. The areas that they directly ruled were Bengal Presidency, Madras Presidency, Bombay Presidency, United Provinces and Agra, Punjab Presidency, Sindh Presidency. But there were a large number of princely states like Hyderabad, 565 princely states like Mysore, like Baluchistan, the Khan of Kalat, like Jammu and Kashmir, Maharaja Hari Singh of Jammu and Kashmir. Like that, there were so many. Sikkim, Tripura, Manipur, so many of them, 565, Junagadh. These 565 were told under the Indian Independence Act that on the 15th of 1947, you will once again become sovereign. The suzerainty or the paramountcy of the British will disappear. And therefore, you are left with three choices. What is it? To continue to remain independent, or to accede to Pakistan, or to accede to India. And they left. India came into existence on 15th of August 1947 with some pockets here and there, some Madras Presidency, Bengal Presidency, UP and Agra, Bombay Presidency. Pakistan came into existence with half of Punjab. Punjab Presidency was broken into East Punjab and West Punjab, with the entire Sindh. L.K. Advani and others, they were all Sindhis. Not an inch of that Sindh came to India. And entire East Bengal as East Pakistan. So Sardar Patel, the Deputy Prime Minister, and the Home Minister, and the Minister in charge of the Ministry of States. We had a ministry called States, S-T-A-T-E-S. By states, what they meant is these 565 princely states. It had a secretary, V.P. Menon. So, and he was also the commander-in-chief of the armed forces. Today, who is the commander-in-chief of the armed forces? Somebody said, the President of India is the Commander-in-Chief of the Armed Forces. But why was Sardar Patel made the Commander-in-Chief of Armed Forces? Why not the President? Think. That's it. So there was no post of President. There used to be a Governor-General. They did not trust the Governor General, the first Governor General of Independent India. What's his name? Correct, Mountbatten. He is the second. So Mountbatten was a foreigner. He is not the first, he is the second. No, that's not the, there is a country called India. It got its independence in 1947. So, who was the first Governor General of independent India? Not Rajagopalachari, Lord Mountbatten. So, they said, we can't trust an Englishman with Indian armed forces. So, the Commander-in-Chief of the armed forces was, that post was given to Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel. He was the Deputy Prime Minister, he was the Home Minister, Minister of States. Minister of State's job is to consult all these 565 fellows and say, why don't you join India? Come, join India. So, he did that job beautifully well. The second, after Mountbatten left, then Rajagopalachari became the Governor General. But by then, Sardar Patel was doing a good job. And therefore, Rajagopalachari was never the Commander-in-Chief. On 26th of January 1950, Babu Rajendra Prasad became the President of India and Constitution of India came into force. And therefore, he automatically became the Commander-in-Chief of the Armed Forces of India. By then, Sardar Patel died also. Gandhiji died, Sardar Patel died, all of them died before India became Republic. Anyway, to come back to this point. So, we had some pockets called independent India. And rest of the country were princely states. Each fellow had his own vicious currencies, like Hyderabad state, Nizam, he had his own currency. He had his own army. He had his own flag. He had his own national anthem. His own administration. So like that, Jammu and Kashmir, Mysore, all of them. It took quite some time for these states to decide whether to become part of India or become part of Pakistan. In the state of Jammu and Kashmir, the king was a Dogri. Dogri means a man belonging to Jammu area. Jammu is north of Punjab. He's a Hindu. But most of the population that he was ruling were in the Kashmir Valley. And that Kashmir Valley had a majority of Muslims. So he wanted to remain independent and continue to have the pleasure of being a king. Almost all, even Nizam wanted to remain independent. Why? Because if they accede to either India or Pakistan, both were democracies. In a democracy, will there be kings? Doubtful. The moment you become part of India, you come under the Indian Prime Minister, Indian Constitution, and Indian President. He is the head of the state. And what happens to this Nizam or Maharaja Hari Singh of Jammu and Kashmir? He'll be an ordinary citizen. So, most of them didn't want to join either India or Pakistan. They wanted to remain independent. One of the earliest fellows to join Pakistan was the Nawab of Junagadh, which is now in Gujarat. It's a district in Gujarat. Junagadh, J-U-N-A-D-A-H. So, the Maharaja of Jammu and Kashmir did not make up his mind. His name was Hari Singh. While it was so, suddenly in October first week, the Pakistani army started occupying. Now I'll go to the maps. The original state of Jammu and Kashmir, I hope you can see it. Yeah, mai hata dun isko. You see, the original princely state of Jammu and Kashmir was a very large state. You see some blue border? Are you able to see blue? Not these dotted lines. Blue. Able to see it? That was the Kingdom of Jammu and Kashmir as on 15th of August 1947. Ruled by a king by name Maharaja Hari Singh. Dogra. the other side of blue is Pakistan. Then, because nowadays they claim all these things as Pakistan, that's a different matter. But Pakistan sent its army and a few tribals, and they occupied all this area. Where is Srinagar? This is Baramulla. Srinagar must be here. Is it Srinagar? Okay. The Maharaja, even today, the Union Territory of Jammu and Kashmir has two capitals, Jammu and Srinagar. Right from 1845, when this particular kingdom was created by carving it out of the Punjab ruled by Maharaja Ranjit Singh. Did you cover that Maharaja Ranjit Singh chapter? Indian history. Punjab was part of India. You've heard of this Maharaja Ranjit Singh, Sardarji, Khalsa, Lahore Darbar. Nahi. 1845 yaar. Achcha, aap log wahan tak nahi aaye. Okay. But he himself is, as you know, the British, they started with Bengal Presidency, Madras Presidency, Bombay Presidency, Sindh Presidency. The last territory that they could capture just before the First War of Indian Independence is Punjab. Why they could not capture earlier? Because of Maharaja Ranjit Singh. He died in 1839, and within 6 years, his sons and all the people became very weak. And this man, Maharaja Gulab Singh, in 1845, he paid 75 lakhs of currency. Maharaja Ranjit Singh's currency was called some Shahi currency. I forget the name now. So 75 lakhs they gave to British East India Company. Then they said, okay, tum paise diye, I will accept you as a king. That is when this Jammu and Kashmir kingdom came into existence. Otherwise, it was a part of Maharaja Ranjit Singh's empire. That included Afghanistan also. Anyway, so in October 1947, by then India was how old? Independent India was how old? 2 months. So they attacked from here and came up to Srinagar in 3 weeks. This Maharaja sent his army and they were defeated. Pakistani army was superior. They killed the commander-in-chief of the J&K army, and the J&K king was about to be captured as a prisoner. So this Baramulla, this is about 40 kilometers from Srinagar. While they were still in Baramulla, when they were still in Baramulla, this man sent a messenger and made a phone call to Jawaharlal Nehru, the Indian Prime Minister, and the Governor General. What's his name? Correct. Why are you all so hesitant? Only one little girl is saying Mountbatten. All the others are thinking that they, some President Roosevelt. India ki vaadendu vastadandi Roosevelt. It had appadiki Rajagopalachari raledu. So this was 2 months after India became independent. He stayed on for 6 months. So anyway, he sent word saying, please send Indian army and save us. The official reply was, Indian army cannot be sent to a foreign country. Under the Indian Independence Act, you got rid of the British. We also got rid of British. We became India. You are continuing to be independent. I can't send my army to you. Then he said, I am being killed. पाकिस्तानी आर्मी इज जस्ट बारामुल्ला और दो घंटे में आ जाएंगे. And they said, there is a solution. Accede to India. Once you become part of India, it is our bounden duty to defend you because you are part of the Indian territory. He said, "Acha, theek hai." So on 26th of October 1947, he signed the instrument of accession. Eppudu? 1947, he signed and ran away to Jammu. Why? Because it is relatively safe. Jammu konja dooramlo unnaru, ikkada ikkada unnaru vallu. Ippunchi ee nallat line unde. This is actually LOC, that is a ceasefire line. Vallu inka ikkada unnaru. Jammu ekanta dooram undi manaku, ikkada undi. So ikkadiki vachesadu by flight. Road ledu aa rojullo. There was no road from Srinagar till 1956. There was no road. This road anedi ikkada huge mountains untai. Here there are what are called Banihal mountains, BANIHAL, Banihal mountains, very high. So the only way to go to Srinagar by road from Jammu is to go from here to Lahore, Lahore to Rawalpindi, Rawalpindi to Muzaffarabad, Muzaffarabad to Baramulla, Baramulla to Srinagar. That is how the Mughals went. The Mughal emperors, all of them, including Jahangir, who died there. Jahangir died in Kashmir. So that was the route. It was very convenient because the Mughal empire included Lahore. So it was part of their empire, no problem. But when the partition took place, Lahore went to Pakistan. So India had to send its army by aircrafts. On the next day, when was the instrument of accession signed? On the morning of 27th, Indian Air Force aircrafts took Indian Army under General Timmaya, Arojulo Brigadier Timmaya, and they went and they landed in Srinagar Airport. One of the big miracles of history is the Pakistani army fellows, they had not reached the airport by then. They didn't capture it. They were still in the outskirts. They were trying to search for the Maharaja who had left after signing the instrument of accession. He went away by a flight to, he had his own aircraft. He went away to Jammu. So they were trying to search for him in a place called Badami Bagh in Srinagar town. The airport is a little far away, like our Shamshabad airport. So these people landed and started firing at Pakistan army. The whole of November, December of 1947 and January, February, March, April of 1948, they were fighting and pushing the Pakistani army back. Who were fighting? Indian Army. Why? So it is part of India, Jammu and Kashmir. The Indian team complained to United Nations Organization, which was by then 2 years old. 1945 October it came into existence. So they said, here is a Pakistani army. It has occupied Jammu and Kashmir, which is legally part of India. Why it is part of India? Because once you sign the instrument of accession, it becomes the property of India, like a gift deed or a sale deed. Supposing this lady buys 1,000 square yards in Jubilee Hills or Banjara Hills. Kya pasand karte hain aap? Banjara Hills from this gentleman. Paise le liya, sale deed executed. So the title of that land is hers. At that stage, let us say this thin girl comes and says, "Ye mera hai." So she goes to the police and says, "Aisa kaisa? Here is a sale deed. And jo becha wo idhar hai Vikas. Vikas? Shashank. Or Shashank. So Shashank, he says, yes, it was mine for 100 years. I sold it away. Paisa bhi mil gaya. Sale deed bhi ho gaya. Then the police will say, chalo, aaja. So they arrest you and take you away. So the Indian government felt United Nations organization will do something like that. They passed a resolution in April 1948. It is a sequential resolution, UNSC, that is United Nations Security Council. And now I am attacking somebody. Whom should I attack? There are so many people. You are not offering yourself. Mujhe attack karo bolke. Ah, good. That is the spirit. Thaliya to bajao. Aap 2 minute mein Google UNSC resolution on Kashmir. There are 6-7 resolutions. Jo April mein pass hua, 1948. You just get the text of that and read it tomorrow. There are, it's a sequential resolution. That means, pehla step number one. First step number one, after step number one is completed, step number two, after that step number three, like that it's a sequential order. Step number one is to direct Pakistan to withdraw all its armed forces, all its tribals, all its citizens, all its residents from the Indian state of Jammu and Kashmir as it existed on 15th August 1947. Matlab, this Gilgit, this Baltistan, this Muzaffarabad, all these things. Unfortunately, they did not. And they were supported by Britain, which created Pakistan, and America.
This video is brought to you by AKSIAS.